swinging in my hammock I fell asleep. I dreamed the dream and I thought it true. Concerned Franklin and his gallant crew, the 100 seamen he sailed away. The frozen ocean, the month of May, to seek a passage around. Hardships they made me strong. The ship on mountain.
I'm not sure what happened. I must have fallen asleep. Well, they say when you're feeling under the weather, you should get lots of rest. And we are under the weather right now. This is the weather station at Franklin Elementary School. It's on the rooftop of the steam lab. So while we're up here, why don't I introduce you to some of the instruments that scientists use to observe the weather. Now over here, we have a thermometer. This is a rather large one. Hopefully you have a smaller one at home for your own use. In this thermometer, there's a liquid in a tube in the middle. As the temperature rises, the liquid goes up. As it cools off, the liquid will drop back down. We'll talk more about that in the steam lab. So that's a thermometer. Another instrument we have up here is actually three instruments in one. This white part here that swivels around, this is a weather vane. Some people say we study the weather in vain, but I disagree. That sounds familiar. Well, they say it's good to recycle. So the weather vane is one of the tools here. The second one is the rain gauge. This catches water as it falls from the sky. At the end of the storm, we can tell how many inches of rain have fallen. And the third instrument moves up and down with the wind. It's a wind gauge. It tells us how fast the wind is blowing. There's a technical word for it. The wind gauge is also called the anemometer. The scientific name for the wind gauge is anemometer. Well, let's see if Lynn knows its technical name. Lynn, what's the scientific name for a wind gauge?
Anemometer, Mr. Carroll.
Oh, right, ambidominator. Let's just call it a wind gauge for now. Another wind instrument we have is the windsock. It will also tell us which direction the wind is blowing. But finally, let's get to my favorite wind instrument, the clarinet. It has a range of 4 octaves, which is only 2 octaves in dog ears. Well, we should head back down to the steam lab. Let's blow! I thought we'd stop here in the workroom. This is where the teachers at Franklin Elementary are using innovative and cutting-edge technology to prepare their students for the 21st century. Now, before we get to the technology, let me put Frank and Lynn over here. That way, they can watch and learn, just like you're watching and learning at home. I'm also going to remove the Borgbjorn. It's incredibly comfortable, but their check hasn't cleared yet, so I'm just going to put this aside for now. Alright, let's look at some of the technology we're using here. This is able to bend metal, and with that metal we're able to bind together sheets of cellulose fiber. You might know these groupings as work packets. And this tool here was designed by graduate students at Stanford University. Recently our entire economy collapsed. We're going to need this in order to cut our budget. Here's an exciting prototype.
This is a graphite-based inscription tool. This was inspired by Neanderthals. They used charcoal pigment to draw on the walls of their caves. But that's not the point. I mean, this is the point. But this is the interesting side. As you know, scientists, students, and engineers make mistakes as they learn. And this allows us to change our answers and try new ones. But now let's turn to the latest technology here in the workroom. This is a Nexus 9 copier, made by the Terrell Corporation. They promise perfect replicants every time. If there's a problem, they'll send out a technician to hunt down and eradicate the anomaly. Oh look, an origami unicorn. Somebody must have been making copies of this earlier. Well, as you remember in our last episode, we promised Dr. Lorak another copy of Lynn. So, let's put the Nexus 9 to work. Come on, Lynn.
Is this going to hurt?
No, this isn't going to hurt at all. All right, so all we have to do is set the coordinates and make it go. Let's see how the Nexus 9 performs. I think it's ready. Wonderful! What a great replica! Well, now we can head over to the steam lab and learn more about weather.
Ooh, that tickles. I think you left the copier on, Mr. Carroll. Mr. Carroll? Mr. Carroll!
Hi there. As I said earlier, today we're going to study the weather. But before we study weather, we really need to learn about air. Because when air moves, it's called wind. And wind can bring clouds, and clouds can bring rain. So if we're going to understand weather, we need to understand air. So what is air? And how do we even know it's there if we can't see it? Well, you can do this little experiment at home. Simply raise your hand and gently wave it back and forth. Can you feel something pressing on it? Well, I hope so, because what you're feeling is air. Air is actually made up of different gases, but since you can't see what I'm talking about, I made a pie chart to help you understand. Let me get it. Oh, no, this isn't the pie chart I was thinking of. This pie chart is for Lynn's baking class. Looks pretty good though, doesn't it? Oh, I'm sure that pie chart is here somewhere. Maybe this is it. Oh no, this is the wrong pie chart as well. This pie chart is for my math class. I probably make this mistake 3.14 times a day. Let me look again. I'm positive it's here. Oh, maybe this is it. Oh yes, this is the pie chart I wanted. This pie chart shows the different gases in air. Now the most common gas around us, nitrogen. The second most common gas is oxygen. And I would hazard a guess and say that amongst mammals, the number one most popular gas? Oxygen. Why is that? Well, we need oxygen for respiration. We need it to breathe. But those aren't the only gases around us. There's other gases as well. Let me get another chart to help you understand. This is the periodic table of elements. I look at it periodically because each square here represents a different atom. Atoms are the building blocks of, well, everything. Everything in the universe. From stars and planets to trees and bees. Even you are made of atoms. So amongst these other gases around us are a group known as the noble gases. They're called the noble gases because they're kind of like royal families. They don't like to mingle with others. They like to self-isolate, if you know what I mean, and I think you do. Well, anyway, amongst the noble gases around us is helium, which you probably know from party balloons. There's also krypton. So while Superman might be a myth, krypton is not. Anyway, we might revisit this again later. Now the great thing about all this scientific knowledge is that engineers can put it to use making inventions that make life easier or better for humans. Now one invention that depends on air is the windmill. When the wind blows, it spins the propellers and inside are magnets. When magnets spin, they can create electricity, all with no pollution. Another great invention based on air is airplanes, and not just paper ones, but real ones as well. Now, I don't know if you've ever been on a plane, but you probably will be someday. And you should know that before takeoff, flight attendants will come through and offer you drinks and probably hand sanitizer. They're also going to offer you parachutes, with the inevitable question, paper or plastic? So, we're going to answer that question today. Which is better, paper or plastic parachutes? But before we get to our project, let's think about paper for a moment. Where did the word paper come from? Well, actually, it comes from right here. This is the papyrus plant. Now, in ancient Egypt, long ago, along the River Nile back here, they discovered that the papyrus plant has stems that are triangular. The Egyptians were able to cut them into strips and glue them together to make paper. That's where we get the word for paper, papyrus. Now, I was in ancient Egypt not long ago and picked up a sample of papyrus paper. On the other side happens to be the first selfie ever taken by King Tut. Teenagers, no matter what the era, they're always hip to the newest technology. Well, before we start building parachutes, why don't we take a moment and listen to our corporate sponsor, the Papel Picante Corporation. The Papel Picante Corporation has come up with hundreds of useful applications for this new technology known as paper. Let's check it out.
When people look at this, they see a tree. But at the Papel Picante Corporation, we see parking tickets, tax forms, and toilet paper. Yes, this might be a living organism producing oxygen and a habitat for small creatures, but it's also a good source of profits and lots of useful paper products. And just because I get paid to say that doesn't mean it's not true. Let's take a look at some of the many ways the staff here at Franklin Elementary uses paper.
I use paper to take notes on notes. Paper is great. I feed my worms with paper.
I like to use paper to practice shooting baskets.
I use paper for art.
I love being buried in paperwork.
I use paper to wipe my...
That was beautiful. Now, not only do trees make our lives better, but we can use them to wipe away our tears as well. So the next time you use paper, I hope you'll think of us, the Papel Picante Corporation.
Wow, thank you, Papel Picante Corporation, for making so many beautiful products out of paper. And thank you for sponsoring this week's episode. All right, now let's get back to this week's project. Remember, we're answering the question, which is better, a paper parachute or a plastic one? I think we know what the Papel Picante Corporation would say, but let's test it for ourselves. This is what you're going to need for your project. You're going to need some paper, some plastic, string, scissors, a ruler, a cup, and a marker, some tape, and a passenger. I'm going to use this little piggy. I had another one here, but I think it went to market. Good thing this one stayed home. Well, you could use a Lego figure or even an eraser if you want. All right, this is how you're going to make your parachute. Well, first thing you need to do is cut out a piece of paper and a piece of plastic that are the same size. To make this a fair test, we're only going to change one thing between the parachutes, the material they're made of. Everything else will be the same. That way we're only changing one variable. All right, now this one and this one are both 8-inch squares. You choose the size you'd like to use. Now once you cut out your paper and plastic, it's time to put it together. This is what I recommend you do. First, cut your string. You're going to cut 4 pieces of the same length. I make mine 1 foot long, but you could choose what length you want. Use your ruler to make sure each string is the same length. Next, tape each string to a corner of your material. Let's start with paper. You tape down the string, and once you do all 4, it should come out looking like this, kind of like a paper jelly. All right, once you've got your 4 strings attached, flip it back over so the strings are face up, and now get a cup. Time to use the marker. What I'd like you to do is mark opposite sides of the cup so that the strings are evenly distributed. This is where you're going to attach them. So do a mark on one side, then the other, then rotate the cup and do it on 2 more opposite sides. Great.
Now, put the cup face down in the middle of your material and attach each string, again with tape, to each of the marks that you made. It should come out looking something like this. This is ready to fly. We just need to add a passenger. This will give it a center of gravity. And now comes the fun part. Find somewhere to drop it from. Somewhere a little high. It's okay with your parents maybe standing on a chair or even a ladder, or a balcony if you have one. But you're going to need a friend, because what you need to be doing is timing how long it takes the parachute to reach the ground. We'll call that the flight time. The longer flight time it has, the better the parachute is working. So do it several times and see what's the longest your parachute will stay up in the air. Then go ahead and assemble the same parachute, but this time use the plastic material, and again, to be fair, use the same passengers you used in the first parachute. Try it several times and see what's the longest time with your next material. Then you'll be able to answer the question, which is better, a paper parachute or a plastic one? Frank and Lynn, what do you think? Which parachute's going to work better?
Plastic. Wait, what? Plastic. Paper.
Other Lynn's?
Plastic.
Oh, what? I must have left the copier on in the workroom. Wait right here with Frank and Lynn and Lynn and Lynn, and I'll be right back. Oh, no. I did leave the copier on. Now I've got a whole lot of Lynn's. Well, it's right between lunch and dinner, so I guess it's dinner time. Well, I'm going to send two of these Lynn's back to the steam lab while I stay here and put these other Lynn's somewhere safe. But you know what? I noticed on the way over it's awfully windy. So I stopped by the weather station to see what's happening. It turns out a mass of cold, dry air is coming together with a mass of hot, moist air. And when that hot, moist air comes together with the cold, dry air, it can create wind. And if the masses are large enough, it can even create a tornado. So you two better be careful on the way back. And in the meanwhile, I'll put away these Lynn's and then put on some extreme weather gear, just in case things get a little crazy outside. Okay, come on, Lynn, and Lynn, and Lynn. I'll be back for you, Lynn, and Lynn, in just a sec. Tornado. Let's go outside and see if there was any damage. Oh my gosh, we're not in Santa Barbara anymore. That's a Sequoia Redwood. The tornado must have picked up the steam lab and dropped us in the Sierra Nevada mountains. That's where these redwoods live. Well, we're going to have to go back into our makerspace and make a vehicle to carry us back to Santa Barbara. In the meanwhile, check out the size of this redwood. Well, we're obviously not in Santa Barbara anymore, so we're going to have to figure out how to get back. So I think the vehicle we're going to use is a helium balloon. Do you remember earlier when we talked about there's other gases in the air? There's oxygen, nitrogen, and these other gases. Well, one of the other ones is helium,
And the great thing about helium is it's very light. Look at this periodic table we looked at earlier. Helium is number 2 because it's got 2 protons and 2 electrons. It's very small and very light. Now nitrogen, for instance, is number 7. That means it has 7 protons and electrons. And oxygen is number 8, so both of them are heavier. So when you take a balloon and fill it full of helium, it's lighter than the air around us. Take a look. We're going to use blue just in case we fly by a beehive, just like Winnie the Pooh, and want to get some honey. Bees won't know we're there. Now look, this balloon is full of helium. In this one, I blew up earlier with my breath. Watch what happens when I let go. 2 different directions. The helium is a lot lighter than the air around us. So what we're going to do is we're going to construct a helium balloon to travel in. This basket will be quite useful. We'll change it from a laundry basket into a gondola for our balloon. Then I'll take some rope, tie it to the basket, and then add some balloons to the rope. If we have enough balloons, we should be able to float. But before we do an experiment like that, we have to see if it's really going to work. So I sent Frank out earlier with the balloon. Let's see if he's had any success. Here he comes now. Hey, Frank, that's doing great. And that's only on a couple of balloons. We're going to need several hundred of them for us to be able to float. Good job, Frank. Come back when you feel like you're ready for it. Okay, kids, so what we're going to do is we're going to add some balloons to the rope so that the rope will lift us up with our basket, and then we'll travel back to Santa Barbara. The only trouble is controlling where it goes. We can control going up and down vertically. And the way that we do that is by using ballast. People in balloons use ballast as weight. So when they want to go up, they cut the cord, the ballast drops, and they go up. So we'll get to work on building our basket and then head outside. We'll see you out there, and then hopefully we'll be able to fly back to Santa Barbara. All right, we've done it. We filled hundreds of helium balloons, and now we're ready to launch. But in order to do that, we're going to have to lose some weight. I think the keto diet's going to take too long. So what we're going to use is ballast. Ballast is usually bags of sand that people in balloons carry. When they want to become lighter, they drop a bag and rise up. Well, let's try it. It's working! Whoa! Uh-oh, better watch out for these trees! Reach the coast. There's an island out there surrounded by fog, and it looks like we're headed that way. Think it is? It's Dr. Lorax Island. What a stroke of luck. Dr. Lorax. It's a good thing we brought along our extra Lynn for Dr. Lorax. Dr. Lorax, stand up! We're gonna airdrop you your Lynn!
It's a good thing we made this extra parachute. Now we can put it to use. We discovered plastic works better than paper. All right, here goes. Get ready, Dr. Lorak.
Thank you, Mr. Carroll.
You're welcome, Dr. Lorak. Knowledge is power. Use Lynn wisely. Looks like the wind is shifting. We're starting to drift back to Santa Barbara. For that tree. Is that a balloon I see up there? Frank and Lynn, I think we need to lose more ballast. Huh?
This pie is fantastic. Good job, Lynn. It's really off the chart. Say, are you going to finish that?
That was fun.